the unsearchable riches of the word of God. Lord, open up the mystery of the word to us this morning. Help us, O God, to hear you clearly. Lord, anoint me to declare your word. Anoint your people to receive your word. I pray, Father God, that the word that will be received today will find faith on the inside of your people. The word of God will profit and prosper your people and bring change to their lives. For this we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. We have been looking at a series titled Understanding the Purpose of Money. Where the purpose of a thing is not known, it will be abused. That's just a natural tendency. Whenever you refuse to know the purpose of a thing, abuse becomes inevitable. And today, we're going to be opening up the scripture to us today to give us a deeper understanding of the purpose of money. 2 weeks ago, we started this series, but obviously last Sunday, we were away in Luxembourg. Amen. Oh, you ought to put your hands together here. Amen. We were in Luxembourg. Luxembourg, what a time we had in the presence of the Lord. The Lord opened the gates of the nation to us. And boy, new wine went in and we took our place. Praise the name of the Lord. Will you help me appreciate everyone who went with us to Luxembourg? We took about 100 people from here, from London to Luxembourg. 100 people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I celebrate you all, those of us who made time to be on the trip to Luxembourg. I know that you've been blessed, and the Lord will continue to bless you. Also, help me appreciate Minister Dimeji, who took the meeting last week. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The message I shared 2 weeks ago was titled, God is the Master, not Mammon. I'm sure you remember that. I'm going to progress from there. But from the onset, I set the stage for this series. Because whenever believers, we hear about the message that talks about money, the first tendency is, oh my God, they are after me again. These preacher people, they've started again. They are after my wallet. I will begin to make preparation and put the wallet deeper under the bag so that during the offering, we'll rummage through the bag. We won't find the purse. But please, tell your neighbor, relax. Say, chill out. Say, God is about to bless you. Open up your spirit to receive all that God wants to do. This is not about getting money from you. It's about getting money to you. The Bible says, my people, they are destroyed because they lack information, for lack of knowledge. But when we are able to gain knowledge, we can apply a whole lot of things and maximize what God is doing. God is a principled-minded God, and God will never violate his own principle. He will never. So bear with me. We look at Haggai chapter 2, verse 8, 2 Sundays ago. We say, the silver belongs to God and gold belongs to God. God owns the money and God also owns the power to get wealth. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6:20 that God owns you. In other words, he owns everything. God does not have a need. Need is not a language that God speaks. God does not have a need. The day God has a need, that day he ceases to be God. God is complete in himself. Nothing missing, nothing lacking. God is complete. The Bible says that in Psalm 50 verse 12, if I were hungry, I would not ask you for food. For the world and everything in it is mine. If I were hungry, in other words, God doesn't come to us and say, give me money, I need to have lunch. No. Each time God gives you opportunity to sow seed, listen to this, it is because he wants to bless you. All right, it's getting quiet now. I said, each time God gives you opportunity, I call it opportunity, to plant a seed, it's not because God needs the money. is because you need the money. And God has put a principle in place by which money can only travel to you through your seed. Praise the name of the Lord. We said your attitude to money will reveal ultimately your attitude towards God. We said the believers are struggling all over the world. The church is struggling badly all over the world because of lack of understanding of the place of money in our lives. Believers are struggling. All you need to find out is that the church has a project to do, to execute a particular goal. I will begin to scramble for money everywhere. When they were going to bring Crossrail to this community, they didn't think twice. It cost them billions. They didn't think twice. How could your father own gold and silver and everything in the earth? How could he own everything and you are still struggling? How? How could your father be so rich, so wealthy, that there is nothing he does not own, but you are still struggling? How? It doesn't add up. There is a particular fundamental principle that the church has not caught. I told you I had a revelation before the start of this series. I saw rain pouring from heaven. And the container that was meant to contain, to receive rain, was misaligned from the streams of rain. So the water was not getting into the container. But heaven is pouring. Heaven is pouring, but church is not catching it. That's the fundamental problem of the church. In Luke 16, verse 10, the Bible says, he who is faithful in a very little thing is also faithful in much. And that is so true. If a person is not demonstrating faithfulness in the little, don't give them the much, because they will burn you. He who is faithful in the little is also faithful in much. He who is dishonest and unjust in a very little is dishonest and just in also in much. What is little? Verse 11. That's Luke 16, verse 11. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the case of unrighteous mammon, which is money, if you cannot trust God with your money, if you cannot trust God that when you give him your money, he will multiply it back to you, how will you trust him to take away your cancer? How will you trust him to deliver you? How will you trust God? If you cannot trust God with 100 pounds, how will you trust God for your family? How? The Bible says, if we are not faithful in the least, who is going to give us the true riches? The true riches. That is so fundamental. And the Bible says in verse 12, and if you have not proved faithful in that which belongs to another, if you cannot use your resources to serve the purpose of God, how do you get back? How do you expect God, heaven, to pour out on you? I'm going somewhere today. Just bear with me. Verse 13. No servant is able to serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will stand by and be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot serve God and mammon. It's not possible. You cannot be controlled by God and be controlled by the desire for money at the same time. Now, if you look at this scripture, verse 13 changes the story. Up until now, God was speaking about money and money and money. But in verse 13, God was using the word serve. Serve. In other words, there is a spirit behind money called mammon. There is a spirit behind money. It's no longer talking about money as a physical entity now. It's talking about a spirit thing. There is a spirit called mammon. The Bible says you cannot serve God and serve that spirit at the same time. Mammon is the spirit that has a tendency to capture and enslave people through the medium of money. Mammon is a spirit that tells you this is what you must do with your money. That your money does not belong to God And so don't give it to God. Mammon will dictate to you what you must do with your money. And you have no objection because you operate under the influence of that spirit. But when you serve God, the Spirit of God will nudge you to serve God with your money because you are under the influence of the Holy Spirit. When you serve Mammon, you are under the influence of the Spirit that controls money. It is also the Spirit that has a tendency to enslave people and make itself the ultimate focus. Mammon makes itself the ultimate focus. Mammon is a spirit that uses money to seduce men away from God and God's purpose. Mammon will tell you, no, you cannot serve God's purpose. As a matter of fact, you cannot be under the influence of Mammon and be hearing God. It's not possible. The only voice you will hear is the voice that tells you where to put your money, but not in God. The scripture says it is not possible to serve God and to serve Mammon. But the question this morning, church, is who do you serve? It's not possible to serve God and Mammon at the same time, but you're serving somebody. You're serving something. Who do you serve? Where does your offering go? Where does your resource go? Who do you serve with your substance? Who do you give your substance to? Some of us struggle. Don't put up your hands to give our tithe to God. Oh my God. Oh my God. There are people looking at me here today who have never given tithe this year. Some of us. And the truth of the matter is, God blessed you with everything. Yes, we are not under the curse, but Christ has redeemed us. But where tithe began, it began with Abraham. The Bible spoke about Abraham that went to war. And as he was coming back from war, he overcame his enemy. He went with 318 trained armies in his house. He overcame the enemy. And was coming back with a lot of spoils of war. Then Abraham met Melchizedek, the prince of Salem, who had no beginning, who had no end. Talk about Christ. And Abraham said, I know my victory was not as a result of my strength. You were the reason for my victory. And as a result, I give you a tenth of everything. Everything that I made from war. Your fight is an offering of gratitude to God for all that God has given you. For all he's given you. Would you serve? Will you serve God or serve the spirit that seduces men away from serving the purpose of God? You remember the children of Israel when they were in bondage. When they were in bondage in Egypt. Who were they serving? Pharaoh. Pharaoh. As long as they were serving Pharaoh, they couldn't serve God. You cannot serve God and serve Mammon at the same time. There is no way. You cannot serve Pharaoh and serve God at the same time. It's not possible. As long as they were serving Pharaoh, they couldn't serve God. That was why many occasions God spoke to Moses, speak to Pharaoh, let my people go that they may. You're getting it now. Let my people go, because unless people come out of the bondage of Mammon, they cannot serve God. Unless people come out of the clutches of Mammon, they cannot serve God. And in Exodus 18, verse 1, and the Lord spoke to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. That's the outcry of God. In Exodus 8:20, and the Lord said to Moses, rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh as he comes out to the water. Then say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. Let my people go. And that's what God is still saying. In Exodus 9, verse 1, then the Lord said to Moses, go into Pharaoh, and tell him, thus says the Lord, God of Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. In Exodus 9, verse 13, then the Lord said to Moses, rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. And that's what God is still saying today. Unless we come out of the clutches of mammon, we cannot serve him. These were the people of God. They were people that had covenant upon their lives. But God is saying, by virtue of this statement, they were not serving me. They were not serving me. And for them to serve God, they have to come out of a system and enter another system. And that was the race that God was running with the children of Israel to bring them under out of the oppression of mammon so that they can serve the truth and the living God. Praise the name of the Lord. Now look at this very interesting discussion that Pharaoh had with the children of Israel. Exodus 10, verse 24. Then Pharaoh called to Moses and said, "Go serve the Lord." Pharaoh spoke to Moses, "Go and serve the Lord." Now listen to this. "Only let your flocks and your herd be kept back. Let your little ones also go with you." Did you get something here? "Let your flocks and your herd be left behind." In other words, you see, flocks and the herd, they represent your wealth. They represent your money. Pharaoh said, "You can go to church and scream as loud as you want as long as the money is in my control. As long as I have the control of money, you can go. Leave your flocks and your herds behind. Leave your wealth behind." And he knows it is with your money that you serve the Lord. Leave your money behind. You go. You go and jump. You go and scream. You go and shout. As long as you've done all those and nothing changes. And that's the situation and the condition of the church up until now. Because somehow we have refused to come out of the clutches of Pharaoh. We have refused to come out. And Pharaoh controls what you do with money. He wants them to go. He doesn't mind them leaving Egypt, provided their wealth is not going with them. The enemy doesn't mind how much tongue you can speak, how loud you could be, how much dance and steps you can take in church, provided there is no money to advance the purpose of God. That's where the devil is. To go, leave your herd, leave your flocks behind. And Moses said, "No. No." But Moses said, "You must also give us the sacrifice and burnt offering that we may sacrifice to the Lord. Our livestock also shall go with us." Praise the name of the Lord. And that is the battle that we are in, church. The battle we are in. God wants to deliver you from the clutches of mammon. But the devil is out there to make sure we don't enjoy the liberty that God has made available to us. God wants to get money to us so that we can worship him with our money. But the devil wants to control our money so that he can propagate his own agenda. In Egypt, when they served Pharaoh, they labored, they slaved to serve Pharaoh. And Pharaoh would gather the money and go and worship his gods. The church would slave and serve Pharaoh, only for Pharaoh to carry the money and go and serve a purpose that is different from the purpose of God. The Bible says in Matthew 6, verse 19, "Do not lay up for yourself treasure on earth. Do not give your treasure to mammon. Lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. Do not leave your treasure to the control of mammon. Let God himself control your treasure." The Bible says, "For where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Where is your treasure? And where is your heart? Is your treasure under the control of mammon? Or under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? I'm going somewhere. I've not reached my message yet. The Bible says in Joshua 5, verse 12, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, as they entered the promised land, manna ceased. You remember that? Manna ceased. When manna ceased, God introduced them to another system of wealth creation. They were slaves up until the time they got to the land of promise. But God said, I want to prosper you. I want to prosper you exceedingly. You never had to remain slaves again. I want to make you financially prosperous. And the Bible says that manna ceased and God gave them something with which to propagate and to multiply wealth. God gave them seed. God gave them seed. Please bear with me. I'm going somewhere. In Joshua 5 verse 12. The manna stopped falling then, and the Israelites no longer had any. No more manna. No more manna. From that time on, they ate food grown in Canaan. They planted and they reaped. They sowed and they reaped. Now, let's extrapolate this and go to the New Testament. Under grace, Galatians 6, verse 7. Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Whatever a man sows, that is the principle here by which we can multiply our seed and we can enter into a place of wealth. And the Bible says it is through your sowing. God gave us the power to determine our harvest. Yes, God made all things available through Christ, but you need a deliberate action of faith to take hold of what Christ has made available to you. God gave us seed. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Then he gave us condition. Give us condition in verse 8. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. In other words, if you allow your flesh to drive you and to determine what you sow, you will gain nothing. There will be no harvest. He who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit, he will allow the Holy Spirit to lead and to guide them. The Bible said they will reap forever, everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good. For in this season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, that's a key word today, opportunity, let us do good to those, to all, especially to those who are in the household of faith. Very importantly. Then Paul took the discussion to the church in Corinthians, in Corinth, in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 from verse 6. But this I say, he will sow sparingly, will also reap sparingly. In other words, God is not interested in sparing sowing. You hear me, church? It's not. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. God is more interested in bountiful sowing. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity. And God is not interested in grudging sowing. He's not interested in sowing as a result of pressure. No. God is looking for a cheerful giver. A giver who recognizes that, yeah, this is my opportunity to serve the purpose of God with my sowing. And verse 8 says, God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. Very importantly, God says, as a sower, hear me, church? Can I have my scripture, please? God says, as a sower, as somebody who gives, God will always make all grace abound towards you. Always having all sufficiency in all things. In other words, in every aspect of your life, in your need, there will be enough sufficiency to meet your need. I may have abundance for every good work. Not only will God give you enough to meet your need, God gives you more than enough to meet your need so you can meet the need of others. Now give me the amplified version, please. Yes. And God is able to make all grace, every favor, and earthly blessing. Oh my God. Say, I am blessed. Say, I am blessed. God is able to give you so much blessing to make the blessing come to you in abundance so that you may always and under all circumstances and whatever the need be self-sufficient, possessing enough to require no aid or support. God is able to give you so much that under every circumstance, under every condition, under every need, you will have everything that is required to meet your need. And the Bible says, and furnished in abundance for every good work. In other words, as a giver, something happens. Because you are a giver, God doesn't just bless you and meet your need. Yes, He will meet your need. Say, I am a giver. Say, I am a sower. That's who God wants you to be. God wants to meet your need. And beyond meeting your need, God will give you in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. God has raised you up to be an answer to someone's question and solution to someone's problem. When God gives you, He gives you what is beyond your own need. Every one of us here seated here, there are destinies attached to you. So that as God gives you, you become a channel by which the blessing of God reaches to those people. Please follow me, church. You become a channel by which the blessing of the Lord that is flowing from heaven into you reaches other. Because you are a giver, two things happen. God bless, He supplies everything you need. Oh my God. Oh my God. It's such a good place to be a giver. Because as a giver, you will never, ever, 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 ever lack any good thing. For everything you need, God will supply grace to make it happen. He will supply earthly blessing to make all happen because you are a giver. The problem in church, is that we withhold. We don't give in church. And because we don't give in church, we disqualify ourselves from the grace of God. We disqualify ourselves. God is looking for givers. Because God wants to bless the givers. God wants to prosper the giver. Because God knows that in blessing you, you become a channel by which others are blessed. Praise the name of the Lord. You understood that? Say, I am a channel of blessing. Say, I am blessed to be a blessing. Say, I am blessed to be a blessing. That's exactly what God has ordained for you to be. To be blessed and to be a blessing. Let's go on, please. Please go to the Good News Translation, please. As the scripture says, He gives generously to the needy. His kindness lasts forever. Verse 10. This is where I'm going. And God will supply seed for the sower and bread to eat. As a sower, now this scripture did not say the sower asked God for seed and God supplied it. No. Now, as a sower, your position triggers something in heavens. You remember Cornelius? The offering of Cornelius was a memorial before God. Heaven cannot forget that. Heaven remembers his offering every single moment. So as a sower, you are remembered perpetually by the system of God. And the Bible says God supplies seed for the sower and what? And bread to do what? In other words, as a sower, God gives you two things. He gives you seed so you can reach out to others. But he also takes care of you. He gives you bread so that you can eat. Praise the name of the Lord. Say, I am a sower. Say, I cannot lack any good thing. As a sower, you never need to struggle another day in your life. Never. Never need to beg bread. Never need to approach bank. Never need to struggle another day in your life. Because God supplies. And you know that when God supplies, he doesn't just supply some. He gives you in abundance. God supplies seed to the sower. And that is where God wants the church to be. God is calling the church to become sowers. There's a problem in the church. We have misaligned ourselves from the supply of heaven. God wants you to be a vessel by which he will reach out to the rest of the world. But somehow in the church, we think of self. We think of me. We think of I. Don't forget, he supplies seed to the sower and bread. So a sower at every point in time has seed and bread. In other words, you are rich. Say, I am rich. Oh my God, say, I am rich. Say, I am rich. A sower has more than they need for their own need. They have so much. In fact, they have overflowing abundance. You see, you could really reach out to others unless you have your need met and you have more. As a sower, you are always in excess. You are rich. You are super rich. But this is the problem. Some people have confused seed for bread. And instead of sowing the seed and reach out to others, oh my God, they go, well, I've got so much now. And they took the seed and they ate the seed. And they took the bread and they ate the bread. And God said, no, this cannot be my vessel. Pass. Pass. I'm looking for sowers. Who is going to reach out to those lepers in India? Who is going to reach out to those HIV victims in Sparrow Village in South Africa? Who is going to reach out to the marginalized in Haiti? You and me. At every point in time, God gives you seed as a sower, but he gives you bread for you. Bread for you. I don't confuse that. And God is looking for sowers in the house of God. Sowers never lack. The attributes of a sower, they never give sparingly. Never. Because they understand the power in sowing. Sower, they give generously. Sowers never give under necessity or compulsion. Mm-mm. They are cheerful givers. They are excited. When they see opportunity, they know this is my hour. Now let's go on. Verse 11. He will always make you rich. Enough. Say, I am rich. Say, I am rich. Did you have to work for that? The Bible says, he will make you rich. He will make you rich enough to be generous at all times. The aim is to make you so rich that you become generous. To be generous at all times. So that many will thank God for your gift which they receive from us. Did you see that? As a sower, you receive seed and you receive bread. As you sow your seed and you eat your bread, your seed that you have sown begins to minister to others, touch their lives. People who have no hope, you begin to reach out to them. And And they look around. They say, my God, God has supplied my need. And they began to give glory to God. In other words, your life now becomes a channel by which God is glorified. Your life now becomes a channel. That's what God created us for his glory. For his glory. God wants to be glorified through you. God wants to be glorified through me. God is not looking for a vessel that will not bring him glory. How many of us will be so sad if our children will not bring us honor? If every time they mention your children is something negative. How many of us? And God enjoys it when people look at you and say, he's a child of God. She's a child of God. Look at what he's done. Look at what she's done. Praise the name of the Lord. Your giving, God will give you so much that you cannot be a blessing, that those that you have blessed may now give glory to our God. Oh, put your hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go on, please. Let's go on. For this service you perform not only meets the need of God's people, but also produces an outpouring of gratitude to God. For your disposition as a believer, by being a sower, not only meets your need and the need of other people, but also produces an outpouring of gratitude unto God. Oh my God, that is the place God wants us to be as a church. That our lives brings glory to God. Our lives begin to bring honor to God. God is looking for sowers. The reasons why believers are struggling in the church, in their lives, is because we are not sowers. We are not. We like to gather where we have not sown. We like to go to place and never give. Never. But God is saying, the day you present yourself to me as a sower, that's the day lack is wiped away in your life. I declare today in the name of Jesus, under the sound of my voice, everything that represents lack in your life is wiped away forever. I declare lack is wiped away forever. Even though you say amen to that, you have to be a sower. You must be a sower. That's just the principle by which the kingdom of God functions. You cannot be another ways. You must be a sower. If I preach a message to you today about healing, without fail, I will make altar call. If I preach about prayer, I will pray for the anointing, grace for supplication. But the problem that Paul identified in the church in the Philippi is this, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 10. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now, at last, your care for me has flourished again. In other words, you are a sower. You are a sower. Though you surely did care, but you lack opportunity. A sower looks for opportunity. And they don't give grudgingly. They give cheerfully. They don't give out of compulsion or necessity. They are excited when they locate opportunity. They know three things will happen. God will be glorified. Somebody beyond them will be blessed. And without fail, they will receive bread. One act of sowing a seed as a sower triggers three results. Three results. And Paul said, he knows that the people care, but they lacked opportunity. I want to give you opportunity today. Now hear me, hear me. I have not told you, give money and this will happen. I have opened to you the word of God. Step by step, I have shown you in the word how God prospers a person who is a sower. And it will be unfair for me to preach a message like this I not present to you an opportunity to sow. Now, I said at the beginning, it's not to get money from you. If you think this man wants to get money, please do not sow. Please, I beg you, do not sow. But the Bible says, believe in the Lord your God, then you'll be established. And believe in his prophet, and you will prosper. If you think this prophet has just come to Babel, do not sow. But if it's the word of God I have presented to you, then you have enough wisdom in you to respond. The Bible says that when you give, it will be given back to you. Full measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will men give to you. Now, in the season that we are in as a church, it's a season of church planting. You just came back from Luxembourg. I'm going to be presenting something to you this afternoon. But I want to give you opportunity. I want to say, as members of New Wine, in the next 1 year, sow £20 a month, apart from your offering and tithe, towards church planting. Or you can break it down and say £5 a week. £5 a week for 1 year. If you calculate that, that's £240, I think. £240. That's not a law. It's not. But I have the responsibility to develop in you a culture of a sower. A sower who is not grudgingly giving, but cheerfully giving. If you want to be grudgingly, if you think, this man, and he said he will not collect money, it's not about collecting money, please do not give. I stand before heaven and the earth. I knew what God shared with me about 18 months ago. That here at New Wine, three things will happen. Number one, there will be outpouring of God's Spirit. Number two, there'll be influx of the nations. And number three, you see, I'm going to be sharing with you this afternoon. And number three, there'll be influx of wealth. Over the past week, I received a phone call from a friend, a minister friend, who told me he's been on retreat and he was praying for me and praying for New Wine. And it was amazing what God revealed to him. I said, look, my friend, wealth is coming to the house of New Wine. I said, wow. I said, that's exactly what God said to me. I told him, as a matter of fact, I am teaching on finance at the moment. This teaching is to position you to receive what heaven is pouring out. And I pray that your container will not be misaligned from what heaven is pouring out. If you come to the and say, my God, come on, let's do the math. Let's do the math. £20 is just nothing in a month. Absolutely nothing in a month. But I'm developing you a culture. There are people here today that want to say, okay, I don't want to give over 12 months. I will give one off. You have opportunity to do so. There are people that will say, okay, Pastor, I want to give more than that. I want to give. You have opportunity to do so. They will give you a card. Part of that card allows you to give a one-off given straight away. And part of the card allows you to give to standing order. You decide whatever you want to do. But I have responsibility as a pastor to preach a message like this, but give you the ground upon which you will sow your seed. Now, three things will happen. Three things. Number one, your life will bring glory to God. As we use your seed in the nations of the earth to bless people, as people get saved, they begin to praise the Lord. That is the impact of your seed. Number two, God gets all the glory. Gets all the glory. Number three, God gives you bread. I don't know what you need, but bread is in your seed. I like that. Your bread is in your seed. Amen. The seed of others is in your seed. Amen. The glory of God is in your seed. Praise the name of the Lord. Ushers, could you help me, please? If there's anyone here that want to give, I don't think there is anybody who should not give, but please don't be under any pressure. Do not be, because I'm not a fundraiser. I've not come here to raise money, but I've come here to give you opportunity. Paul said, I know they care for me, but they lacked opportunity. They lack opportunity. What you are doing here, you are confronting the spirit of mammon. I'm sure you know that. You are confronting that spirit by your giving today. You are challenging that spirit, the spirit of mammon. And you are saying, mammon will have no more control over my money. Today, I become a sower. I become a sower. Yes. 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 The power of mammon is broken right now off of you. You become a sower in the kingdom of God. Yes, Father God. Yes.
We hope you have been blessed by this message today. For more details, visit our website, newwine.co.uk. You can email church at newwine.co.uk. Connect with us on Facebook at New Wine London or follow us on Twitter, also at New Wine London. New Wine Church, where you're valued, not numbered.